All right, we're in Mark chapter 7 this morning, starting in verse number 1. And we read through the first part of this chapter at the close of our last lesson and just mentioned a couple things, but we want to go back and talk about this section of Scripture. It's, of course, contains some vital lessons for us to learn, going all the way back to Old Testament times, and we're going to try to bring those two together in our study this morning. Verse 1 says, "Then came together unto him the Pharisees and certain of the scribes which came from Jerusalem." We talked about last time how Jesus was in Gennesaret, so he's in Gentile country at the Sea of Galilee. But these Pharisees and scribes, these leaders of the nation of Israel, came all the way from Jerusalem to seek him out, not because they want to be believers, but they're trying to find something on him. The opposition to Jesus is beginning to grow and grow stronger, which, of course, it will continue to do until ultimately he is put to death. And so in that setting, in that context, verse 2 says, "When they saw some of his disciples eat bread with defiled," that is to say, with unwashing hands, "they found fault. For the Pharisees and all the Jews, except they wash their hands oft, eat not, holding the tradition of the elders. And when they come from the market, except they wash, they eat not. And many other things there be which they have received to hold, as the washing of cups and pots, brazen vessels, and of tables. Then the Pharisees and scribes asked him, Why walk not thy disciples according to the tradition of the elders, but eat bread with unwashing hands?" And before we get into Jesus' answer to them, there's some important things to notice here. First of all, the explanation that Mark gives, where he says that, you know, they asked him why his disciples didn't eat with their hands washed. And Mark goes on to explain what that means. Their unwashed hands to the Jews were defiled. And then he talked about how the Pharisees and most of the Jews followed those traditions of washing their hands often, and they wouldn't eat without washing their hands, and how when they went to the market, when they came home, they would wash their hands, and all their traditions about washing pots and pans and all of those things. That tells us that Mark was not writing to a Jewish audience. If he were writing to Jews, they already knew all of this. So Mark was writing to Gentiles. Some say Samaritans, who were part Jew, part Gentile, but there was a Gentile element in the audience. And so he had to, and of course this is by inspiration of the Holy Spirit, but he had to explain to the audience what these traditions of the Jews were. And we're glad that he did that, because we're not Jews either. And without things like this given to us in the Bible, we might not know to dig more deeply into certain things to find out, you know, about these traditions. And so when we do and we start to look at what the Old Testament teaches and what the Jews practiced, we see that there were some very significant differences. And I think probably that originally some of these traditions of the elders started with good intentions. There's some writings in Jewish history that talk about the traditions of the elders were meant to be a hedge, they call it, a fence, if you will, around the law of Moses. And so the idea was, at least initially, or at least what they claimed their motive was, that God's law sets boundary lines, and if you cross those lines, then you've trespassed. And we understand that principle. If it's a piece of property and there's a boundary line, the sign says no trespassing. If you cross that line, then you've broken the law, right? You've trespassed. So God's law sets certain boundary lines, and in order to make doubly sure that they didn't cross God's boundary line, if God's boundary line was here, if it was his boundary line was at the front of the pews here, they would move that boundary line back to the stage. And so they say, if you stay in this boundary line, you don't even get close to God's, and therefore you won't sin. You won't violate the law of Moses. So that was just kind of the principle of making these traditions, to be a hedge around the law. So if God says you can go this far, we move it back enough to make sure you don't even get close. The problem with that is twofold. One is that now you have this area between what man says and what God says, which God calls this area okay. It's not sinful. It's not wrong. But man says that it is sinful and it's wrong. You have man making something or declaring something sinful that God has not, which puts man in the place of being the lawmaker and saying that his wisdom is better than God's wisdom. No matter what the intention was, that's what the end result is. And so you have this area of practices that are not wrong according to the law of God, but man has deemed them to be wrong. And so that's the first problem. The second problem is that when you do that, you begin to elevate your traditions above God's law. And that's exactly what the Pharisees did. They made lines of fellowship where God had not made those. So if you violated the tradition of the elders, you were a sinner, even though technically, according to the law of Moses, you hadn't sinned at all. You'd just gone against what they declared to be sinful. And that principle hasn't gone away. There are still those in the Lord's church today, we call them antis, whatever name you want to give them, but they have sometimes good intentions, and they make rules to try to protect people from doing wrong, but they end up making their law supersede the law of God. One example has to do with having Bible classes like we're having this morning. There's a movement, and some of the motives, you know, were no doubt just. Sunday school, as we know it, you know, started in the denominations. And when people in the Lord's church started having the desire to do that, they were viewed as just trying to copy what the denominations were doing. Whether or not there's a scriptural foundation for it, just because somebody who's wrong does it, doesn't make it wrong. The Bible, you know, gives us the principle that the church has the responsibility to teach. And we can do that in sermons and preaching, but it's also valid to have a period of Bible study. And to divide that into age groups, you know, there's no scripture that keeps us from doing that under the oversight of an eldership. So it wasn't wrong just because the denominations did it, but some felt that it was. But then others, one of the big arguments against having Bible classes was that if we do that as the church, then parents are going to think that that meets their obligation of bringing up their children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. So you send them to Bible class, and you don't have to teach them at home. And so parents would stop teaching their children the Bible at home if we have Bible classes. Well, that may happen, or it may not happen. But just because something might happen that is not right doesn't mean, you know, by default, that the Bible class situation was wrong. But that's what their belief was, and they made it a law that if you have Bible classes, then you've sinned. And the problem is, of course, that that's not what God said. It wasn't God's law, it was their law. And their motive was to try to encourage parents to teach their children, which they should. And, you know, if we're honest with ourselves, a lot of parents have stopped teaching their children at home because they send them to Bible class. Some parents send their kids to Bible class and worship service and don't even come themselves. But that's not right. That's sinful and it's wrong. But that doesn't mean that the Bible class is wrong. But they made that a law, and they made drew lines of fellowship, which is the same thing that the Pharisees were doing. And it ends up with man putting himself in the place of God and saying that our opinion and our doctrine is superior to what God has said. So whatever their motive was, the Pharisees had come up with these traditions, and as time went on, they built one on another until by the time of Jesus, you know, there were hundreds of these traditions, and many of them still exist today in those who practice various forms of Judaism. There's the Babylonian Talmud, which has all kinds of laws and regulations and interpretations about Jesus and those things. They still condemn Jesus for breaking the tradition of the elders. They say that God appointed the Sanhedrin to make the laws for Israel, and if Jesus didn't do what the Sanhedrin said, then he was a sinner. Well, he wasn't a sinner. He just didn't do what they said he should do. He still obeyed God. He just didn't obey their opinion about what God said or their interpretation. And that's exactly what's happening here. And those who hold to Judaism today still have that same view of Jesus, and that He deserved to die for doing those things. So that's the principle of the traditions of the elders. So when they make this argument and they come to Jesus and they say, why don't your disciples keep the tradition of the elders, but they eat their bread without washing hands? And by the way, you can read the Old Testament from beginning to end and you'll never find a law that says you have to wash your hands every time before you eat. Or when you go to town and come back home, you have to wash your hands. The principle was there are certain things that you can touch that'll make you unclean and defiled, and so you have to go through a cleansing process. So the Pharisees said, well, if you went to the marketplace, it's possible that you might have touched something unclean, so when you come home, wash your hands before you eat, just to make sure that you're not defiled. Well, it's also possible that you didn't touch something that is unclean, but they made it a law that you have to wash your hands. You must do this. And then they instituted that law on, you know, many different occasions. It's kind of like Paul talking about meat offered to idols, right? You go to the marketplace and there's meat for sale and you don't know if that meat, where it came from. It could have been meat that had been offered in sacrifice to one of the idolatrous gods. So if I, as a Christian, buy that meat and take it home and eat it, am I participating in idol worship? Well, there were some Christians who felt like they were, and then there were others who understood that they weren't. And Paul gives the law of God on that, and he says the idol is nothing, and the meat offered to the idol is nothing. You can't participate in worship of something that doesn't even exist, and you as a Christian know that these false gods aren't real, and so when you eat that meat, you're not worshiping them, you know, unless you willingly do that kind of thing. But he also said, you can't make it a law not to eat meat offered to idols, but if you have an opinion about it, a scruple, your own personal belief that if you eat that meat, you'll be participating in idol worship, he said, then don't eat it. You can't make that a law for everybody, but you yourself don't do that because for you it would be sinful because you believe that it is. And he encouraged those Christians to be careful about influencing their brothers and sisters to do something that they felt was sinful. But God's law was clear, and man didn't have a right to make his own law to take precedence over God's law. So the Pharisees asked Jesus, why don't your disciples keep the tradition of the elders? And if you've learned anything from studying the gospel accounts, it's when you ask Jesus a question, you better be ready for the answer, because people try to entrap him, they try to get him to accuse someone else or to fuss at someone else, and he always turns it back on you. And that's exactly what he does here. So notice his answer in verse 6. He answered and said unto them, well hath Isaiah, which is Isaiah, prophesied of you hypocrites, as it is written, this people honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Howbeit in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. For laying aside the commandment of God, ye hold the tradition of men, as the washing of pots and cups, and many other such like things ye do. And we'll read a little more in just a minute, but notice that he says that tradition of washing pots and cups, that's your law, and you have to put aside God's law in order to keep your law. And so you've put your will in the place of God's, and that makes you a hypocrite. You're acting like you're obeying God when in fact you're doing what you want to do. So we pretend, you know, to be religious and holy and we love God and we're serving him. And the truth is we're making God in our own image and we're changing his will to fit ours. And that's hypocritical. And so he calls them out on it. But he says that they are exactly as Isaiah prophesied. And I want us to go back to Isaiah 29 and notice what he said in this passage and how it relates to the Jews in his day, the children of Israel in his day, and carries forward all the way to the time of Jesus. So in Isaiah, starting in chapter 28, there are a series of woes that are pronounced upon the children of Israel. And all of this is leading up to their being taken into captivity because of their sin and rebellion and idolatry. So the first one is chapter 28 at verse 1. It says, woe to the crown of pride, to the drunkards of Ephraim, whose glorious beauty is a fading flower, which are on the head of the fat valleys of them that are overcome with wine. So the first woe has to do with their pride. And they demonstrated that in the way that they lived, particularly in their drunkenness. Then you come to chapter 29, verse 1 again, you have a woe. Woe to Ariel. Ariel is Jerusalem. To Ariel, the city where David dwelt, add ye year to year, let them kill sacrifices. Yet I will distress Ariel, and there shall be heaviness and sorrow, and it shall be unto me as Ariel. Now, before we talk a little further about that, I want you to notice also in this chapter, at verse 15, there's another woe. Woe unto them that seek deep to hide their counsel from the Lord, and their works are in the dark, and they say, who seeth us, and who knoweth us? Surely your turning of things upside down shall be esteemed as the potter's clay. For shall the work say of him that made it, he made me not? Or shall the thing framed say of him that framed it, he had no understanding? And notice particularly that passage and that woe, they were turning things upside down. God was the potter, man was the clay. And so the potter shapes the clay into, you know, whatever he wants it to be, a bowl or a cup or whatever. And the thing made doesn't turn around and say, well, the potter didn't make me, I made myself. The thing that was framed, you know, as a piece of art doesn't say, well, whoever painted me, whoever made me, had no understanding. They didn't know what they were doing. But that's exactly what the people of God were doing. God gave us his law, but he really didn't know what he was doing. We have a better law. So that's the pot calling out the potter and of course, being blasphemous toward him. But that was the problem with the children of Israel. And real quick, notice chapter 30, verse 1. Woe to the rebellious children, saith the Lord, that take counsel, but not of me, and that cover with a covering, but not of my spirit, that they may add sin to sin. They walk to go down into Egypt and have not asked at my mouth, to strengthen themselves in the strength of Pharaoh and to trust in the shadow of Egypt. So they're rebellious. They ask counsel, but they don't ask God. What does that mean? That means they take their own counsel. They ask one another and they leave God out of it. And then they go down to Egypt. They don't ask God to help them or to protect them, but they lean on these other nations that God is bringing into judgment. And of course, who can't save them. So again, they're rejecting God and his knowledge and his wisdom for their own. And one more we'll read, chapter 31 and verse 1, which ties in with this one. It says, woe to them that go down to Egypt for help and stay on horses and trust in chariots because they are many, and in horsemen because they are very strong. But they look not unto the Holy One of Israel, neither seek the Lord. So again, they're putting their trust in all the wrong places, everywhere except God. So with those in mind, those woes, let's go back to chapter 29 and read a few verses here about Ariel. We read verses 1 and 2. Verse number 3, he says, I will camp against thee round about, and will lay siege against thee with a mount, and I will raise forts against thee, and thou shalt be brought down, and shalt speak out of the ground, and thy speech shall be low of the dust, and thy voice shall be as of one that hath a familiar spirit out of the ground, and thy speech shall whisper out of the dust. And so God's going to bring Jerusalem down. He's going to defeat Israel, and then, of course, later Judah, and take them into captivity because of their rejection of him, and they're instituting their will above his will. And by the way, you notice there in verse number 4, when he talks about having the voice of a familiar spirit, it gives a little insight into how those who practiced sorcery worked. They told you they could communicate with the dead, and then they used trickery to make it sound like the voice was coming out of the ground, like a dead person was talking. This is like ventriloquism. They were able to cast their voice and use means to make it sound like somebody dead was talking to them. But it was all just a trick. It wasn't real power, real magic. It was deception. But anyway, that's how Israel's going to be, like one in the ground trying to cry out. Verse 5 says, moreover, the multitude of thy strangers shall be like small dust, and the multitude of the terrible ones shall be as chaff that passeth away, yea, it shall be at an instant suddenly. Thou shalt be visited of the Lord of hosts with thunder, and with earthquake, and great noise, with storm and tempest, and the flame of devouring fire, and the multitude of all the nations that fight against Ariel, even all that fight against her and her munition, and that distress her, shall be as a dream of a night vision. It shall even be as when a hungry man dreameth, and behold, he eateth, but he awaketh, and his soul is empty. Or as when a thirsty man dreameth, and behold, he drinketh, but he awaketh, and behold, he is faint, and his soul hath appetite. So shall the multitude of all the nations be that fight against Mount Zion. So you've probably done that. Have you ever had a dream? You go to bed and you're kind of hungry, and while you're sleeping, you dream that you're eating something, and it's so good while you're eating it in your dream, and then you wake up, and it's so disappointing because you actually haven't eaten, and you're still hungry or you're still thirsty, and you have to get up and get something to eat. Well, he says that's how it is for these nations. They're going down to Egypt saying, Egypt, help us and deliver us from our enemies. And God says it's like a dream of food. There's no substance to Egypt. They can't help you, nor could any of the other nations that they were trying to get on their side. They had rebelled against God. God's bringing judgment. There was nothing they could do to stop it. And so all of their, you know, movements and action following their will was only increasing their sin. So notice verse 9, he says, stay yourselves and wonder, cry ye out and cry. They are drunken, but not with wine. They stagger, but not with strong drink. For the Lord hath poured out upon you the spirit of deep sleep, and hath closed your eyes. The prophets and your rulers, the seers, hath he covered. And the vision of all is become unto you as the words of a book that is sealed, which men deliver to one that is learned, saying, read this, I pray thee. And he saith, I cannot, for it is sealed. And the book is delivered to him that is not learned, saying, read this, I pray thee. And he saith, I am not learned. So God says, here's the problem with Israel. It says that God has poured out upon you the spirit of deep sleep. And that doesn't mean that God has deliberately caused this to happen. But it means that because they have rejected God, and they haven't listened to him and listened to his word, and they've imposed their own will, that now when it comes time to read the Bible, to read what God says, they can't understand it because it doesn't fit with what they've been taught all their lives that God's word teaches. So all their lives they've heard these traditions, you have to follow this law and you have to do this, and then they open the Bible and they read it and none of that's in there. And so they don't know what to think and what to do. So the unlearned person says, well, I'm not learned. I'm not smart enough. I haven't gone to school. I'm not a scribe. I'm not a priest. I don't know what the Bible teaches. So I'll just do whatever they tell me to do, right? And then you come to the wise person who's supposed to be learned. And he says, well, the book is sealed. It's like closed up and I can't even understand it. Because they're not listening to God, they're following their own will. So their eyes have become blind to truth. Their ears have become deaf to truth, not because God forced them into this, but because they chose to replace God's will with their own. It's like today trying to talk to some who are in the denominational world, and you talk about a very simple Bible principle, and they have no idea what you're talking about. Because all of their lives, what they've heard is this denomination's teaching, which is not to be found in the Bible anywhere. You talk about the sinner's prayer, right? They'll tell you up and down, this is what you do to be saved. Pray this prayer, the sinner's prayer. And you say, well, where's that in the Bible? Well, they know it's in there, but they can't find it. And they can't find it because it's not actually in there. But they've heard it all their lives. And so at the end of the day, they throw up their hands and they say, well, I'm not smart enough to understand the Bible myself. We just have our differences of opinion, and I believe what I've been told, and you believe what you've been told. But the answer is to go back to God's word and not to close our eyes and our ears to it. So look at verse 13. He says, wherefore the Lord said, for as much as this people draw near me with their mouth and with their lips do honor me, but have removed their heart far from me, and their fear toward me is taught by the precept of men. Therefore, behold, I will proceed to do a marvelous work among this people, even a marvelous work and a wonder. For the wisdom of their wise men shall perish, and the understanding of their prudent men shall be hid. And then they have the next woe in verse 15. But notice the language that he uses here. They draw near with their mouth, which means they say words that sound like it's God's word. They talked about God, and they knew the name of God, and they knew Moses and his law, and all of those, they knew the terminology, but their heart was far from him. They weren't calling upon God with their heart, just going through the motion with their mouths, thinking that by saying the right words, that somehow merited God's favor and salvation and forgiveness and all those things. He says, with their lips do honor me, but have removed their heart from me, far from me. And notice, their fear toward me is taught by the precept of men. And this is the big problem. Their fear of God was not taught by what God said, but by what man said. So God gives us the standard by which we should fear him and reverence him, honor him and respect him. But man has a different standard. Instead of fearing God for what he says, they say, well, you don't need to fear God about that. That's not really sinful. It's okay if you do that. God will understand and he'll overlook it. So you can do that and not have to be afraid of God, when God said it's a sin and it's an abomination and you'll be put to death for it. But they didn't like what God said, so they changed it. And they taught men to fear God by the precepts of men, not by what God actually said. So the people had a misunderstanding of God, of his very nature, and of the nature of his word, because they had been taught man's law instead of God's law. But they were taught man's law in words that made it sound like it was God's law. So they used the right words to make it sound like they were talking about God, but they were actually teaching their own precepts. So God says, I'm going to do a marvelous thing to this people. All these things that their wise men have said, they're going to see that they have been lied to, that those men were not wise at all. It's all going to perish. The understanding of those they thought were prudent, it's going to be revealed to be false and to be lies. It's a bright light of truth is going to shine upon them, and they're going to realize that they've been deceived. Now, for them, that meant the Assyrians and then later the Babylonians knocking on their door and dragging them away captive. All these things that their false prophets said would never happen because God loves us more than everybody else, they're going to find out that all those people were wrong. And that very same principle is what Jesus is talking about in Mark chapter 7. They were following the example of their forefathers, and they're going to learn the lesson of their forefathers. And they had a choice. They could either learn the truth about how they had been lied to and they'd been deceived. They could learn that either by listening to Jesus and accepting the evidence that he presented, that he was the Son of God and that his word is truth, or they could learn it when Rome surrounded Jerusalem and razed that city to the ground and destroyed Judaism. And once that happened, you know, that's the end of the story. Or at least it should have been. There's still those who hold to this, cling to this hope that the Messiah is coming one day in the future, but they ignore the truth of Scripture and even what the Old Testament taught and how Jesus fulfilled those things. So the same judgment is coming, but this time it's going to come through Jesus, through the preaching of the gospel, and then ultimately through the destruction of Jerusalem. So when the Pharisees ask, why don't your disciples keep our traditions? Jesus' answer is because your traditions are deceiving people. You're saying words that make it sound like you're telling them God's will, but you're actually preaching your own will. And he gives this example back in Mark 7, and I'm going to read this real quick, and we'll look at it more in depth next time because it's important to understand it. But he says in verse 9, full well ye reject the commandment of God that ye may keep your own tradition. For Moses said, honor thy father and thy mother, and whoso curseth father or mother, let him die the death. So that's the law of God. And that's simple. That's easy to understand. Honor your parents, and if you curse your parents, you deserve death. Verse 11 says, but ye say, though this is their law, their tradition, if a man shall say to his father or mother, it is Corban, that is to say, a gift, by whatsoever thou mightest be profited by me, he shall be free. And you suffer him or allow him no more to do aught for his father and his mother, making the word of God of none effect through your tradition, which ye have delivered, and many such like things do you. The basic idea of Corban was that the Jews had this law, this tradition, that a man who had money could dedicate or devote a certain amount of that money to the temple. And it's kind of like a will. When I die, this money goes to the temple. But when you set aside this amount of money for the temple, then you are supposed to keep it over here and not use it for anything else. So when your parents began to age and began to need your help and your care to provide for them and to take care of them, you would say, well, I would love to, Mom and Dad. You know, I'd love to move you into my house and feed you and care for you. But all the money that I have saved up, I've devoted to the temple. So I just can't help you. I'm sorry, but you're just going to have to suffer on your own. And then they would turn the temple into, you know, it was a money laundering process. And that money would come back to them and they'd use it to do whatever they wanted to with it. But they created this loophole to get around what Moses said, honor your father and your mother. They didn't want to do that because they were selfish. And so they created this loophole and claimed that this was the law of God. And Jesus calls them out on it and he says, your law actually not only sets aside the law of God, but he says that you make the word of God of none effect. You take away the entire force of one of the Ten Commandments, honor your father and mother, by this false law, this tradition that you've made up. So that's why my disciples don't keep the tradition of the elders, because they're not only foolish, but they are deceptive and they're hypocritical and they're causing people to break God's law rather than to keep it. And so that principle, again, carries on throughout all the ages of the world, that we have to hold to what God says and not what man says. And there's one more lesson we have to learn from that, but we're out of time. We'll have to do that next time. But I want us to talk a little bit about honoring your father and your mother and what that means and what this verse teaches us about that. And then the importance of making sure that we know why we do what we do. Because if we don't, we're in the same category as these Jews who just did whatever somebody told them to do. And we don't want to find ourselves in that condition. So we'll talk about those two things, Lord willing, in our next lesson. But we'll stop here. We'll pick up there next time.